edition, another episode, another season of Casual Movie Club. It is so great to have you here. I'm so glad you're here. We are at season 5 of the Casual Movie Club, episode number 52, and we are back with you for more fun with some fabulous and fantastic movies. So hope you all had a wonderful break, a wonderful Christmas and New Year's, and I cannot do this podcast without my good pal, Brian. Wait a minute. Brian's chair is empty. This is weird.
No. Whoa. But I'm here. Hey.
Hey, Brian, coming to us live through the magic of the internet and thanks to Skype, who is not a sponsor. We've got Brian coming in remotely because he is on business in... Where are you, in Mozambique this week, or where are you?
This week I'm in Libya.
Oh, okay. And the next week you're in Mozambique, or are you in, are you climbing K2 next week?
Next week I'm in Mozambique. This week I'm in Libya.
Oh, gotcha. Okay. And then when do you summit K2? Is that in 2 weeks or 3 weeks?
That's 3 weeks.
Oh,
and that's going to be my off time.
Oh, okay. You're doing that as a little side project.
Just going to mosey on over to K2, just, stroll up the top, take a look around, see what I can see, and then, back on down.
But now, are you going to be able to do that in 13 hours?
Well, I'll do my best. I'll have to report back on my progress, but I'll do my absolute best to be up and down and back within 13 hours.
But watch out for the oubliettes.
I will watch out for the oubliettes, especially on my way through France.
Right.
Because I don't want to be put in a windowless dungeon.
Right. And also, I'm guessing you probably don't want to fall through a pit of hens.
No, I don't. No, I do like hens.
Hey, you know, I mean, who doesn't like getting a little handsy? But we
Big
are.
Big fan of hens.
What's okay? All right. Well, you know what though? this in my usual attempts to put some clues out there, y'all know already what movie we're doing. We did Labyrinth.
Yes.
We did Labyrinth from 1986, and I'm gonna start this out like we start out all the other ones. Brian, what'd you think of it? Did you like it? Did you enjoy it?
I love this movie. This was a breath of fresh. I was excited to come back and visit my old friends. I had a great time revisiting this movie. Yeah. I had seen this in my younger years. My parents were big fans of Jim Henson and all of the other movies, Dark Crystal, Neverending Story, anything that had like live action puppets and fantasy in it. Like I was all in. So. Yeah. I've seen this movie multiple times, but it's been a few years since I've seen it. So it was really great to come back to it.
And evidently, this was Jim Henson's last film.
Yeah, his last feature film that he directed.
Yeah. But, did he work on a few other ones after this, or was this was it? Because I forgot to look on IMDb, and of course that would involve, fact-checking.
Internet research,
we don't do that.
I don't know. Okay. He may have produced things, but I know that he didn't direct anything else.
Right. But yeah, I completely agree with you. This is such a great movie. And, I don't know that I'm going to say I adore this movie, because it's not one that I would watch all the time, but it's one of those, like if I'm on a date and I'm hanging out and my date's like, hey, I really, let's watch Labyrinth. I'll be like, yeah, okay. Like it's a movie I'll watch if it comes on, or if someone is in the mood to watch it and we're hanging out. I don't know that I'm going to sit down on my couch and say, let's watch Labyrinth, but it's a great movie that I'll watch if it's on, kind of thing.
Yeah. I differ only in the sense that if I'm scrolling through and I see it, I will put it on.
Yeah.
As long as the mood, matches like what I'm currently doing.
Yeah.
Like if I see it, like if I have an opportunity to put it on, I'm going to watch Labyrinth.
Yeah. You know,
I like the movie a lot.
That's cool. That's cool. So, I've got two things to ask Brian. So may I ask you two things?
I would, I would love it.
Okay,
please
cool.
Do.
Cool. So I'm actually going to start with my second question. Is this a kid's movie?
Yes, it is a children's movie. Absolutely. What about it makes you doubt that? The dams that were thrown around?
Well, I mean, yeah, I don't necessarily doubt that it was a children's movie, but I was more asking if you think this was made to be a kid's movie intentionally, or, well, I'm not even asking the question right. Was this engineered and built specifically as a children's movie, or do you think it kind of became one through how they did it kind of thing? You know, because I could see this going both ways. I could see it being one of those, you know, like the Muppet movies. I feel like they are, mm-hmm. they're not necessarily totally kid movies because adults can appreciate them too. What do you think?
Well,
what do you think?
Well, the Muppet movies are, they are for children. They are unequivocally for children, but there are things in there that adults can appreciate.
Yeah.
So, while I can't say that the same thing is true for this movie.
Yeah, that's and that's what I'm getting at.
Yeah, as an adult, I didn't see anything that new anyway that would have went over my head as a kid.
There
was really nothing for maybe the dark tone, I suppose. But even as a young kid, I had friends that grew up watching this movie with me also. So I wouldn't say that this was not made with kids in mind. Now, I don't know the history and the backstory of the script and the production and all that. I do know that there was a couple of documentaries made about this movie, but I've never seen them. As far as I know, in all of my viewings, this is a kid's movie. Okay. And I still enjoy it as an adult.
You know what? I mean, I agree with you. I am a giant kid. I'm a 39. Oh, I'm going to be 39 this year, but I'm a 38-year-old kid.
Mm.
You know, I always believe in being a kid at heart. So, you know, I'm a giant kid. So I
don't want to grow up.
Yeah, I'm a Toys R Us kid.
Toys R Us kid.
Yeah. So okay, cool. So that's a good answer. And then my other question for you, and then, you know, who is your favorite creature of the labyrinth, and more specifically of the kind of main characters that we meet throughout the way. You know, Hoggle, Ludo, and Didymus. Who would you say is your favorite? Would you say is the one you relate the most to? And do you feel like there's a parallel with those characters at all to something? Because I recognized a parallel. I don't want to see if you picked up on it.
Oh, really? I don't know if I see a parallel to any of them, but I identify the most with Ludo.
Really?
Love Ludo.
Interesting.
Yeah. The other guy, Didymus, I like him. He's very he's full of moxie and spunk, and he's funny. He's probably he's the funniest character in the film.
Yeah.
The most comic relief, if you will, but love me some Ludo. He's big, he's lovable, he's lunky.
Yeah. He's the character you want to just give a huge hug to.
He reminds me of like a wild thing, like from Where the Wild Things Are. That's what he reminds me of.
Okay.
But I do like Hoggle too, but Hoggle's kind of a dick.
He certainly warms up later on in the movie, but he does come off like a dick at first.
Yeah, he was forced into being a dick also later on with Jared and the Peach and all that stuff. I love me some Ludo.
Okay.
I'll go with Ludo all day. How about you? Who was your character?
I definitely would say Didymus.
Really, Didymus?
Yeah.
I like Didymus. Didymus is great. He's a fun character. He's the funnest character.
Yeah, I would say that I relate most to Didymus. Now, the parallel that I see is the Wizard of Oz.
I wrote a couple of those things down.
So Hoggle is the Cowardly Lion. He's he admits that he's a coward, but he courageously jumps in to help out. Ludo's kind of like the scarecrow. He just seems like he's not smart. He doesn't know very much, but he cleverly uses his ability to summon the rocks in order to help. So he's smarter than he comes off like he is. And then Didymus
or Ludo.
What's that?
Hoggle or Ludo?
Ludo. Because Hoggle I see is the cowardly lion. You know, he's okay. Because like the cowardly lion says, "Oh, I'm a coward. I'm going to see the wizard for courage." But Hoggle demonstrates courage throughout the movie by jumping in to help when Sarah is in trouble.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Ludo kind of comes across like the scarecrow because he seems like he doesn't know very much, but he's smarter than he alludes to being because he calls upon his ability with the rocks, and you know he seems like he does have these moments of being smart. And then Didymus is kind of like the Tin Man in a way, you know, because he has that loyalty and that he has that heart of being, you know, when he's at the bridge and he says, "Oh my, it's my job to stand here and not let anybody pass without my permission." And he's got a strong heart, you know, and he's the one at the end who says, "If you ever need us, you know, just call us, you know, we're always here for you." He's got heart, but you know, Tin Man's the one who goes to the wizard to get a heart. So I've found that those three seem to resemble the three people in the Wizard of Oz.
See, I wrote that down like early in the movie and then just kind of like forgot about it and continue to watch. I didn't get the same character parallels that you did.
Okay.
But because I really didn't think of it like that thoroughly, but I totally agree. Totally see it.
Yeah.
Sarah is Dorothy. Ambrosius is Toto.
Oh yeah. Okay.
Also, I also, what made me think of the, Wizard of Oz parallel the most was the fact that Sarah's running around. She sounds a lot like Dorothy, just the way that she talks, the way that she comports herself. She keeps screaming "No fair," and it sounds a lot like Dorothy. She's just running around saying "No fair to this, no fair to that," and it was the very first thing that she yelled at her stepmom when she ran up to the house in the rain, and that was the first. It just reminded me of Dorothy so much.
I could totally see that.
But there's also like allusions to Wicked Stepmother because that's not her mom.
Right.
She says as much.
Right.
There's also a bunch of other fantasy elements. The dog, his name is Ambrosia in the Labyrinth, but in the real world, dog's name is Merlin.
Right.
Her favorite doll's name is Lancelot. There's fairy tale stuff all throughout this movie.
Right.
And I love it. It's great.
I wonder though, what was Sarah's? How did this story? Because obviously we know it's Sarah's reading a book. The Labyrinth. We never really found out what her fascination was with this story. Like, is she acting in it in a play because she's got a costume and she's running around and, you know, you could almost say she's rehearsing for a play. So we don't know if she's acting this, you're going to be acting this in a school play, or is she just obsessed with the story? Like, we don't know where this story comes from. Like,
see,
her fascination
now,
with
first,
it.
At first I thought that she was rehearsing for a play.
Yeah.
But then she, Jareth alludes to this a couple of times. Jareth, by the way, the first introduction to him where he swings the ball around and says, "Oh, the boy's mine. The boy's mine. The baby's mine. Don't come for the baby."
Right.
And she's like, "Oh, no. I changed my mind. I want the baby back." And he says, "Don't defy me." And he throws a snake right in her face. So funny. I thought that she was auditioning for a play or she was doing this for school or something like that. But Jareth alludes to this, like she's just into fantasy so much. And you can tell this by the dog's name is Merlin. All of her dolls are named Lancelot and she's got knights and stuff all throughout her room.
Yeah.
I think that she's just obsessed with fantasy.
Yeah.
She's obsessed with fantasy. And this is just something that she's really passionate about. That she's really into.
It's just one of her things.
Yeah. I don't think that this is like a play that she's rehearsing. This is just like, this is what she does for fun.
It's the story she just happened to be reading during the story arc of this movie.
Exactly. Yes. And is this even a book? I don't think this is a real book, is it?
I don't know. I haven't looked.
I've never looked either.
We can look after the podcast.
Can't look now, of course.
Because, you know, on the podcast, we don't do internet research.
No, we can't.
I found it funny when after, you know, right before Jareth came to take the baby and she's, you know, the baby is crying and she's complaining and she goes, I can bear it no longer. You know,
who talks like that?
Yeah,
that's another.
Who talks like that? I was waiting for her to go like, you're so annoying, you little shit, you know, or something like that. This isn't even a Disney movie. So, you know, that she didn't have to censor herself. She could have just been like, you know, shut the fuck up, you little shit, you know, or whatever.
Well, to me, that's another indication. That's another clue that this is just, she is really into high fantasy. She's really into like old English style speaking.
Yeah.
Shakespeare. And like, this is her bag.
Right.
So yeah, another indication that like, this is how she is.
Yeah. No, I'll totally give you that. And So the screenshot I sent you of my little notes here, you know, I found it really funny. Baby cries incessantly. Sarah very annoyed. Baby stops crying. Why aren't you crying? Karen in the making.
Yeah. She was just like,
I just
totally like not in, like, what do you want? Make up your mind, Sarah.
Make up your mind. Exactly. Now, I could not think of anyone else to pull off the Goblin King role. You know, David Bowie was awesome as the Goblin King. Could you think of anybody else in that role?
At that time, mid-80s, probably not, because they were just, I don't know, he was perfect. Bowie's perfect for that.
I mean, he wrote a number of the songs as well. So, I mean, what rock star, I guess we could say rock star, but like what musician from that time period could have pulled off that, you know, that role, but also pull off the writing of the music and singing the songs and all that stuff. I think he was really just like spot on for the role.
Well, I mean, yeah, he was definitely spot on for the role. I mean, anybody else could have written those songs. They probably wouldn't have been as good,
right,
or maybe as fitting,
right,
but somebody else could have written those songs for him.
Yeah. What did you think of Dance Magic or Magic Dance or whatever it's called?
See, now this is the thing. The songs were catchy. They were like toe tapping, but I didn't like the songs.
I love Magic Dance or Dance Magic. I don't know what the actual name of the song is. I'll look it up after the podcast. But
the first song where he throws the baby around.
Yeah,
and
the whole, you remind me of the babe. What babe? The babe with the power.
Babe, the power babe. Who do? You do. Voodoo.
Voodoo, yeah. I love that song. I've always loved that song. So I forget where I was going with that. But no, I love the songs in this. And I thought, with David Bowie's unique styles, I thought it worked well for the character of the Goblin King, kind of being this sort of out there kind of guy. You know what I mean? Like,
mm-hmm.
He had that, like, especially that last song when she was walking around the room with all the staircases on upside down and stuff, which I was going to ask you, is that inspired by like a famous painting or something? Because I know I've seen that before with the staircases going in all different directions and upside down and everything. I thought that from a visual standpoint and the effects and everything were brilliant. I thought that was really cool and very well executed.
Yeah, amazing. Didn't like the song.
Really?
didn't like the song. Like if I had to pick a favorite song, it would be the one with all of the little red monsters throwing their throwing their heads around.
See,
but
I hated that one.
Oh,
I couldn't stand that one. I didn't like it at all. It's like I forget the name of that one, but it was, I mean, there were a few moments during the movie that dragged or that I could do without, and that was definitely one of them.
Yeah.
Like, that was one of them. And then the scene where they're in the ballroom dancing, like, where she's in the ballroom gown and, you know, she's dancing with David Bowie. Like, I could have done without that. That felt really, really slow to me.
Yeah. I thought the songs, I don't know, man. I didn't like the placement of the songs. They all felt unnecessary. All the songs felt unnecessary to me. I could have done without them.
I don't know if I could agree with them being unnecessary, but I felt like they were just placed in there. Like they didn't, like, if you took them out, you wouldn't be taking away from the story.
Agreed. Yeah, I agree with that. 100%.
Yeah. So, so I don't know if I could go so far as to say they're unnecessary, but I totally see where you're coming from. One of the notes I have is I think that the movie was shortened because I feel like there were certain, like, connecting scenes that were cut, because a lot of the edits, I feel like when we went from, say, one section of the Labyrinth to another, there was a blatant change in, like, there was no blatant connection between the first, from where we were coming from and where we were going. So, like, when she talks to the little worm at the very beginning, and the worm's like, oh, you know, don't go that way, go this way, and she goes that one way, then the next scene you see is she's in this completely different area of the Labyrinth, and you see no transition between the two areas. Now, again, I get it, there's got to be some sort of suspension of disbelief, but, I mean, it's like two completely different scenes or two completely different sets, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I see what you're saying, but there's a lot of that. There's a bunch of those things where that's one example. But then she goes from the hedge maze to like the stone
right.
maze.
Right.
There's a few like jarring scenery transitions.
Yeah, and I mean, and that may just come down to suspension of disbelief.
Yeah.
It may, just because of the fact that we're dealing with kind of a magical labyrinth, you know? So
we
like,
are. Yeah. The other thing about that, like about this magical labyrinth is like the Goblin King wants the baby. He wants Toby, right?
Right.
And he wants to keep Sarah from finding Toby.
Right.
Why did he transport her to the labyrinth in the beginning? Leave her in her bedroom. Leave her stranded on outside of the magical plane.
True, but then there'd be no movie.
There'd be no movie, of course, but...
you know, it'd be like, here, let me show you this labyrinth, but we're not going to go in it because I'm just going to leave her in her room to be fucked, you know? So,
yeah.
But, no, I agree with you. I mean, yeah, I mean, there would have been no movie or no story if he did that.
Yeah, like, their parents would come home and they'd be like, what the fuck? Where is our kid? Where is Toby?
Oh, he was abducted by the Goblin King. It's okay.
Abducted. What were you doing? You're supposed to be watching him. I got to go return some videotapes.
I was double clicking my mouse. I'm sorry.
How did you feel about the ending?
It felt a little bit rushed, but
abrupt, right?
Yeah, it was a little abrupt. But I didn't mind that because I was, I mean, what was the total? I have the IMDb page open. What is the running time of this? It was an hour 41. 40? So, yeah, 1:41. So, I mean, I was kind of done with the movie by then. So I was okay with it being a quick ending.
Yeah. The movie didn't wear out its welcome for me.
Yeah.
The bog of unbearable stench.
Yeah.
Maybe was a little long, but I would blame that on the red monster dance.
Yeah, which I could have done.
And then I my favorite song in the movie, but could have done without that sequence altogether.
Yeah, or at least shorten the song.
Shorten the song.
Yeah.
Battle sequence at the end where they are storming the Goblin City. It was very chaotic, but I liked it. It was original. Yeah,
it was, and it didn't feel long to me. Like, it didn't feel too long because you saw everybody kind of struggling and fighting the army that was charging them, but then Ludo called the rocks in and everything was fine. So
yeah.
it didn't drag on too long for me, which I was totally fine with. Did you draw the connection to Ludo being like Garignac from Galaxy Quest?
No. No, so, not at all.
So do you remember Galaxy Quest, the big rock monster?
Oh, yeah.
You know, I kind of thought Ludo was similar to that rock monster because he commanded the rocks and he and whatnot, but I mean, it was just some stupid parallel.
That's funny.
Karignac.
No, I didn't think of that.
Yeah. So, and I think I asked you this before. We started talking about it before. That room that happened, that room that that sort of finale was in with between Jareth and Sarah, was that based on a painting or something? With the
it is. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. That's a famous famous painting. I don't know who paints it, but I've seen that before. It's also like a fairly standard, like paradoxical example of a paradox.
Yeah.
Because all those stairs lead to nowhere. There's right. a more simplistic version of it where you have a staircase that's climbing in a stair.
Yeah.
But if you're looking at it on like a flat 2D surface, a piece of paper or a painting or whatever, it's an endless stair. And I don't know who originated it, but it's one of those classic paradoxes.
Yeah, it's one of them art things.
Yeah.
Nice, man.
Artsy.
It's exactly. Do you have anything else you want to mention, or do you want to do some numbers?
We actually covered most of it in our general discussion there. Practicing for play. Oh, 80 sacks, very prominent throughout the whole movie.
Oh, yeah.
I could have saved that for our numbers. Yeah, I'm good. Let's do the numbers.
Cool. All right. And by numbers, we're talking about that which you would see on our leaderboard. And speaking of numbers, ladies and gentlemen of the Casual Movie Club, to which all are welcome, check out our previous episode, the little special that we released in the middle of January prior to this one. But the numbers on our leaderboard may be changing. We released a special, and if you're wondering what I mean by that, go listen to that previous special, because you may see some different numbers on our leaderboard. But for now, the leaderboard is where you can find the scores to the movies that we watch and that we rate for you. We talk about 6 different criteria, and I'll run through them super quick for you. We have the acting, which is how well did the actors convey the story, how believable were they? We have the script, how well was the dialogue written? Brian, what else do we have on there?
There's presentation. How does the editing and visual effects, how are they used? Were they too much? Were they not enough? Next is music and sound, soundtrack as a whole. How were the sound effects, the score, the music, the
goodies for your ears?
There you go. And what are the last two categories?
We have the uniqueness. Has this movie been done before? Does this have tropes and things that we've seen in other films? Or is this completely brand spanking new that we've never seen before? And then we have the engagement factor. How close to the edge of your seat were you? Were you dying to know what other creatures Sarah and the gang were going to come across in the labyrinth? Or were you looking at random vertical videos on Instagram TV?
I didn't know that was a thing.
Yeah. Sidetrack. Apparently, Instagram TV are vertical videos. And that goes against everything I stand for as an audiovisual professional. Anyway, rant over. I hate vertical videos, if you couldn't tell. But, such a weird segue. Let's go into acting. Brian, what do you think of the acting of this movie?
A lot of the performances, I think the acting as a whole was carried by the puppets. Love Jennifer Connelly, love David Bowie, but you didn't really have any other human actors in this film. You got the parents, of course, but the parents only have a couple of lines of dialogue.
Yeah, they weren't in the movie that much.
No, the Muppets, the puppets were. Carried the film. They were phenomenal. Yeah. But David Bowie and Jennifer Connelly also really great. Acting a 4.
Right on. Very cool. Well, I agree with most of that. You know, I definitely think the puppeteering work was excellent. The acting for me overall was very good. Nothing blew my socks off, so to speak. It's going to be a 3.5 for me. Just cool. just right there in the middle, you know, above the middle. So script for me, I liked the story. I liked the, you know, I liked the kind of fairy tale element of it. Some of the dialogue I thought was a little cheesy, you know, and with some of these movies, like, I'll kind of start it at a 3 and I'll add points and detract points kind of during the movie. My end score for the script was a 3. I thought it was good. Nothing blew me out of the water. I didn't hate it. There was nothing that offended me or upset me about it. I thought overall, by and large, it was solid, but nothing made me want to give it anything more than really a 3.
Oh, okay. Well, personally, I thought the script was really well done. It's a pretty well done script as far as the dialogue goes. You've got standard tropes in there. You've got the main protagonist gathering up friends as they move through the story there. And we did talk about some of the references to other fairy tale stories, Wizard of Oz especially.
Yeah.
But I thought that if we're judging it off the dialogue based off of that, I thought it was really well done. I liked it a lot. I'm going to give the script a 4.
Cool. All right. And how about presentation? What did you think of the presentation?
Man, we talk about green screen a lot on this show.
Yes, we do.
And there was some green screen. There was definitely some green screen in this film.
Oh yeah.
But the more egregious green screen I thought was just overshadowed by how well the effects were used overall. The fairies section in the very beginning when she gets to the labyrinth was my opinion, very, very well done. The puppets, the explosions, all of the effects were done to phenomenal usage. I loved it. I thought it was presented very, very well. I'm going to give it a 4.
Cool. Well, I agree with you. There was quite a lot of green screening, I thought, but what felt kind of obvious to me was sort of towards the beginning. Do you remember when she had just entered the labyrinth and she's looking down the long corridors? You could definitely see that she was looking down that, and then there was a painting that was representing the rest of the length, you know?
Right.
And I could tell just through kind of technique when she was running down the length of the labyrinth, how it was never, the shot length was never longer than about 2 seconds, because they only had a small length of labyrinth, and I'm you know, air quoting the word labyrinth, where she would just run from one end to the other, and they would put different you know, logs and everything in there for her to run over, and they just kept doing quick edits to kind of get around that. So they definitely, I could see where they were doing some of these things, but maybe it might just be my overly critical eye in 2020 talking about a movie that was made in 1986. You know what I mean? So it's they, for the time period, they did very well. You know, my presentation is going to be a 3.5. I was happy with what they did. I spotted some things, but I'm going to give it more than a 3. I realize I'm being kind of harsh this week. Usually you're the one that's harsh. I kind of find that funny.
That's unusual. I didn't spot those presentation things, that the painting and things like that. So that's interesting. Yeah. I know that technique that you're talking about, but it washed over me. I didn't notice it. So
yeah.
Good eye.
Cool. Thank you. So music and sound, I really liked the soundtrack. I liked the music. I really liked the songs. And I thought that just utilizing David Bowie as not only a singer, but as an actor, and also, you know, kind of a songwriter and that sort of thing, using his music in there in addition to his acting, I thought was a really great choice. Solid 4 for me for music and sound.
I love the score. We talked about 80 sax already.
Yep.
Prominent throughout the score. and David Bowie's great. I love David Bowie. But the music, while it didn't detract from the film, it to me, it didn't really add anything that I felt was necessary. There wasn't a banger. There wasn't like one standout song. So you know how like in Wizard of Oz you have the Yellow Brick Road. That's or yeah. over the rainbow.
Over the rainbow.
Over the rainbow. Or Frozen's Let It Go.
Yeah.
There wasn't a standout song in this movie for me.
You didn't think Magic Dance was a standout song?
Which one was that?
Magic Dance or Dance Magic? I'm probably getting the name wrong, but you know, Magic Dance, Dance Magic, that one.
Is that with the red guys that are dancing around the fire?
No. The first one we see where you know you remind me of the babe. What babe? The babe with the power.
Babe with power. Power of the babe.
Voodoo, power of voodoo. 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 You do.
I mean, I remember that song.
Yeah.
But I don't. That doesn't feel like thematic.
Oh, okay.
Of the movie to me. Okay. Instead of going, yeah. I think I've made all my points. I'm going to give music and sound a 3 even.
Okay. And then uniqueness. What did you think about the uniqueness factor?
This was pretty unique story for what it is. It did remind me a lot of The Dark Crystal, which is another Jim Henson movie.
Okay.
As 1982, 1983 maybe.
Okay.
Movie, but that's there's no humans in that. That's all focused on just like gelflings and like little creatures and stuff.
Okay.
But a lot of the same creatures. There's also the Neverending Story. Have you seen the Neverending Story?
No, I've not.
We should do the Neverending Story. It's a like 1984, I think. Okay. 1984 movie.
Cool.
Really, really good. If I were to compare Labyrinth to anything, it would be Neverending Story. But okay. They're only similar, like on the surface. The stories are naturally very different.
Okay.
You do have two characters wishing to go into other worlds, and that happens, and then they have the adventures, and that ensues. I'm gonna give uniqueness a solid 3.
Cool. All right. I've not seen things like The Neverending Story and, you know, other than The Wizard of Oz parallel that I kind of drew there, I did feel like this was pretty unique. You know, especially with the, then again, there's like the Muppet parallel as well, but I mean, that's a Jim Henson thing. It's just it was a method of how he showed those creatures. But, for me, I really liked it. I also liked the use of, you know, kind of a famous musician in using David Bowie in that role as both an actor and a musician and everything. I'm giving uniqueness a 3.5, but I agree with most of what you said.
Cool.
And then engagement factor for me, I went back and forth on this one. You know, I started at a 3, and then, you know, kind of during a few of the really interesting scenes, like when she would get to the different kind of roadblocks in the labyrinth, the little interactions that she would have, they were kind of interesting. But then there were some kind of scenes that felt a little bit draggy and that I kind of zoned out a little bit and, you know, checked my phone a little bit and corresponded with a couple of people on text messages and everything. Engagement's going to be just a solid 3 for me. It's a good background movie to have on, but it's a movie that will draw you in if you enjoy this type of thing, but it's something that you could have it on in the background and still enjoy it.
Yeah, I agree with all that. You can definitely, as long as you've seen this before, it's a decent background movie.
Yeah.
I think a lot of fairy tale type movies fall into that category. As long as you know the story, if you've seen it once or twice,
yeah,
you don't really need to be totally engaged.
Yeah.
I was very engaged in this movie, but then again, I haven't seen it in a long time, and I also grew up watching it several times. I went from started at a 3, similar to you, and then went up to a 4. I think I'm going to settle into a 3.5.
Okay. Very cool. And do you want to – so now that our scores are entered, would you like to do any take-backsies before we officially mark them as locked in?
I'm looking over my scores. I feel good. Yeah, I feel pretty good about acting 4, script 4, music sound 3. Yeah, I'm good. No take-backsies for me.
No take-backsies for you? Okay. No problem. So I'm also going to say mine are good. So the score. So would you say the scores are in?
Scores are in, baby.
Numbers are in. All right. So ladies and gentlemen, boys, girls, goblins, and hands of all ages, the scores for Labyrinth for our first movie of 2020, first movie of season 5 of the Casual Movie Club, episode number 52, Labyrinth from 1986. The scores go a little something like this. Acting 3.75, script 3.5, presentation 3.75, music and sound 3.5, uniqueness 3.25, engagement 3.25, for a total average of 3.50. So that actually sits it right at the same level as the Poseidon Adventure.
Wow.
So I'm not sure where this is going to rank it, if it's going to stick it above or below Poseidon. But both are at 3.5. I'm thinking Poseidon might... Well, Poseidon's got a 4 for presentation. So Poseidon might still wind up being up above it. But,
I don't know how I feel about that.
You know, I mean, it's... I think it's Labyrinth is a solid movie. You know, it's a solid movie. And it's sitting kind of right in the middle of our list. You know, things that are... Cadence is above it. Santa Claus, Dennis the Menace is above it. True Lies is above. Well, we can't really talk about that.
I guess not. No.
Clue is above it. Seven is above it. Mrs. Doubtfire. So, I mean, those are good movies to be above it. Speed 2, The Wraith, Knock Knock, Scooby Doo, Drop Dead Fred. Those are below it. I think that's quite fair.
I would say fast. That's fair. Yeah.
Yeah. So cool. So that's it. So that's our first movie of 2020. Now, what are we doing next week? Do we want to tell everybody, or is this going to, or are we doing a surprise next week? What are we doing?
You know, we haven't done surprises in a while.
Shall
we? You want to do a surprise?
Yeah. May I pick a surprise for next week? May I?
Yours is good. Yeah. You do a surprise next week.
Cause wasn't Drop Dead Fred the last surprise we did, and that was yours.
That was mine, yes.
Okay,
so
cool.
You do this surprise, okay. And then we'll go back to like a couple weeks of planned stuff, and then I'll surprise.
Nice.
Maybe at the end of February.
That sounds good. Cool. So I will. I'll pick a movie for us for next week. We'll be all surprised, and then next week are we doing this again next week? Or are you here next week for next episode? I forget.
Well, I'm in Libya this week.
Oh right.
Next week I'm in.
Or next week you're in Mozambique or Zimbabwe.
Mozambique.
No, what are you in LA or San Francisco?
I'm in San Jose.
Oh, that's right. Okay, so you're traveling next week. So we'll do the same thing next week. But we'll so I guess I'll just tell you the movie to download the day of, maybe.
Oh yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or okay, maybe because you're traveling. Maybe we'll both agree on something, and that way I can do the surprise when you're here. Right?
Well, we still have to do one next week, though.
Well, yeah, but I mean, maybe you and I'll decide on one together, and that way when you're here, I'll do the surprise one when you're here in the studio.
Okay. Yeah, let's do that.
Okay, so everybody, you'll be surprised, but we both won't be because we're going to know what it is, but... either way, we will see y'all next week on the Casual Movie Club, episode number 53, season 5, episode 2. We're so happy to have you back, and we'll see you then.
See ya.